So actually, that was all we were going to talk about in this lesson about computational learning theory. So let's just recap where we went so far.
Okay. So what, you want me to do it?
Yeah, that's been our technique all along.
That's fine. So here you're the teacher and I'm the student. I get that, which is actually one of the things that, we talked about.
Aha.
We talked about what it would mean to be a learner versus being a teacher, and how teachers and learners interact to make learning happen faster or not.
Okay.
But that was actually in a larger context, which I thought was kind of cool, which was this sort of notion of trying to understand what's actually learnable, right? And I think the comparison that made sense to me was that we were trying to do the equivalent to what we do in computer science with complexity theory and algorithms, where here we were bouncing up from a specific algorithm like decision trees or KNN and asking a question about how fundamentally hard is the problem of learning.
Good.
Yeah, I like that. And we focused on a particular measure of difficulty, which I guess drove everything else that we talked about, which was sample complexity. You know, how many examples, how many samples do we need in order to learn some concept?
Good. Yeah, it's a really powerful idea because it's a different resource than what's normally studied in computer science, things like time and space. This is now how much data do we need?
Right, which makes sense because we do machine learning, and machine learning people, what we care about is data.
I saw a T-shirt recently that says data is the new bacon.
Mm. So you're saying data is delicious?
Yeah, I think we like data a lot.
I love data. Okay, so that ties us back into the discussion about teachers and students, because what we talked about was how if the relationship between the teacher and the student was one way versus another way, we might get different answers about sample complexity. So in particular, we talked about what would happen in a world where the learner had to ask all the questions.
And that's powerful because the learner knows what the learner doesn't know, but the learner doesn't know what the learner needs to know. So that is somewhat powerful, but it may be useful for the teacher to be more involved.
Right. So that's the other thing where the teacher gets to actually pick the questions.
Great.
And then the third sort of case was where the teacher didn't really pick the questions, or the teacher didn't have an intent to pick the questions, but the teacher was in fact nature. So like a fixed distribution.
Yeah, good.
Right. And some of those are, you know, easier to deal with than others. Like the teacher, since the teacher knows the answer, can ask exactly the right set of questions to get you there very quickly. Versus, say, when the teacher is just nature and, you know, you get it according to whatever distribution there happens to be.
Sort of oblivious, maybe is a better word.
I think unfeeling.
Nature just doesn't care about me.
I think nature cares about you just as much as nature cares about everyone else.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was afraid of.
Yeah. Okay, so let's see. What else did we cover? So we talked about mistake bounds as a different way of measuring things. You know, how many mistakes do you make as opposed to how many samples do you need? That was kind of neat. There was some tie-in there. And then the bit that I like a lot is we started talking about version spaces and pack learnability. And what really worked for me with that was this distinction between training error, which we've talked about a lot, test error, which is how we've been thinking about all of the assignments we've been doing, and true error. And true error in particular got connected back to this notion of nature.
Right, the distribution D.
Right. And then you introduced the notion of epsilon exhaustion of version spaces and gave us an actual sample complexity bound for the case of distributions in nature.
And the sample complexity bound is pretty cool because it depends polynomially on the size of the hypothesis space and the target error bound and the failure probability.
So actually that reminds me, I had two questions about this, Michael.
Uh-huh.
So the first question was that equation, m greater than or equal to 1 over epsilon times the quantity natural log of the size of the hypothesis space plus natural log of 1 over delta, closed quantity, assumed that our target concept was in our hypothesis space, didn't it?
Yes, that's true.
So what happens if it isn't?
Then we have a learning scenario that's referred to in the literature as agnostic, that the learner doesn't have to have a hypothesis that is in the target space, and instead needs to find the one that fits nearly the best of all the ones in there. So it doesn't have to actually match the true concept. It has to get close to the best in its own collection.
Okay. Well, so do we get the same bounds?
It's a very similar bound. I think maybe there's an extra epsilon. There's an extra squared on the epsilon. I think there's maybe slightly different constants in here. So it's of a very similar form. It's still polynomial. It is worse, though, because the learner has kind of less strength to depend on.
Okay, that's fair. Okay, so then my second question was, I just realized, staring at this now since you wrote it in red, that the bound depends upon the size of the hypothesis space.
Indeed.
So what happens if we have an infinite hypothesis space?
Well, according to this bound, the technical term is you're hosed.
Oh, is that what the H stands for?
Yes.
So N would be greater than 1 over epsilon times the natural log of infinity, which I'm pretty sure is infinity.
Yeah, even once you multiply it by 1 over epsilon. So, yeah, you know, this is a really important issue, and I think it really deserves its own lesson. So let's put this off to lesson 8. You're right that the infinite hypothesis spaces come up all the time. They're really important. Almost everything we've talked about so far in the class, like actual learning algorithms, deal with infinite hypothesis spaces. We would really like our bounds to deal with them as well.
Yeah, I would like that.
So, I don't know, anything else to talk here, or should we say without further ado, let's move on to the next lesson?
I think we should say without further ado, let's move on to the next lesson.
All right, then without further ado, let's move on to the next lesson.
Okay, well then I will see you next time, Michael.
Sure, yeah, thanks for listening.
Oh, well, you know, I enjoy doing it so much. Bye.